Ladies and gentlemen, my name's Paul. Hope you're having an amazing day. There has been an absolutely humongous leak regarding AMD's next generation products on the Zen 6 side of things, as well as UDNA, formerly known of course as RDNA 5. And we have some really interesting insights regarding the PlayStation 6 and potentially 3D stacked dies, as well as the Xbox as well. There is a lot of stuff to get through here, so we're going to get right into it after this quick message from the sponsor of the video. If you're running a copy of Windows 10 which isn't activated, of course, not only do you have to worry about the missing customization options, but there's also that annoying Windows desktop watermark reminding you to activate. Today's video is sponsored by WhoKeys.com, and they have an excellent price on Windows 10 Professional as well as Home Keys. Yeah, and they also, of course, sell games. I've bought a few Windows 10 keys with my own personal account to test everything was legit and worked in preparation for this sponsored video. You can pick up one of their keys for 25% off using the coupon code RGT in the checkout. There's links to their website in the video description. Also, if you're building a few systems, there's bundles available too. Again, you can check out WhoKeys.com and use the coupon code RGT for 25% off the listed Windows 10 key prices. Now, right off the bat, I want to say that Zhangzonghao has had a really good track record, and they typically post on the Chip Hell forum. Unfortunately, they speak in Chinese, or rather type in Chinese, and I can't natively read or speak that language, so of course we're going to be using ChatGPT. With that said, if someone has a slight correction to what's said, we'll give you guys the Chinese version first, and then obviously we'll translate, we'll put the ChatGPT translated version on. So if there is anything that's slightly off, do let me know in the comments below. With that said, let's get into it. So, he states, and I quote, the Zen 6 CCD will use the N3E process, the IOD process will be N4C for GPU, UDNA, which again is formerly known as RDNA 5, will use the N3E process. The return of the flagship large core has been mentioned before. So basically, this is in reference to the GPU, but I'll get more into that in a second. For the APU, the next generation Halo products will use 3D stacking to simultaneously improve CPU and GPU performance. The packaging methods will be revealed in the second half of this year. Currently, the simplest solution is, quote, shared memory. I find that really interesting. On the console side, Sony will adopt 3D stacking, but it's not yet clear whether Microsoft will do the same. There is a lot to unpack here, and I'm going to reach out to some of my sources on some of this information, but let's just really quickly break down some of the, you know, the big rocks. So with Zen 6 for the desktop, yes, N3E, and the IOD, of course, is going to be N4 process. Most likely, the server, from what has been leaked previously, is going to be using the N2 process. Basically, well, typically speaking, AMD wants to allocate the more expensive and best node, of course, to, well, the server market for obvious reasons. However, it's possible that this is only going to be the dense variants. And again, there has been a lot of confusion regarding the core count, especially on the desktop side of things. I still think that we may technically see an increased core count, but I don't think it's going to be like with the big cores. I think most likely we're going to see 8/8 with the IOD featuring some low power cores as well. And those are going to be used for things like background tasks. I have covered this in a previous video that was maybe about a month and a half ago. So I don't want to speak too much about Zen 6 here because there is so much other stuff to cover. As for UDNA, or the RTX formerly known as RDNA 5, for those who don't know, AMD have changed the naming scheme is because basically the architecture going forward is going to be a lot more harmonious. Obviously, while there will be some differences between, let's say, the server variants, like, for example, it might utilize HBM, for example, they also want to, from my understanding anyway, include things that have been somewhat borrowed from the MI series of graphics cards, like basically the Matrix cores, albeit with some differences. And I think, honestly, this just makes sense because, for example, if we look at the gaming side of things, just look what's happening with AI for things like upscaling. And this is going to continue to be a big deal over the next several years. Like, you know, frame generation is going to continue to evolve. We're going to start to see neural rendering. Nvidia are, of course, incorporating that and heavily marketing that with the RTX 50 series. And you can bet your bottom dollar that AMD will also be following suit. It's going to take a while before game engines completely and utterly change from the traditional rendering pipelines. But basically speaking, these features are going to continue to evolve. And AI can be used for a ton of different things. It's not just like upscaling. It could be everything from generative content as you're kind of, you know, moving through the game worlds, upscaling of textures, and naturally even just more advanced characters, for example NPC, and just tons of other stuff. Anyway, again, I'm going over this very quickly here, but the main point is that the Halo products from AMD will actually be making a return. So while RDNA 4, most likely the 9070 XT, is going to be around the 5080, 5080 Super level of performance, AMD most likely will be targeting the highest end UDNA parts against Nvidia's, like, you know, flagship RTX 60 GPU. So let's say the 6090 or 6090 Ti. And now I want to spend a few minutes talking about the PlayStation 6. I have previously put out some videos where I discussed the fact that I believe, according to my sources, the PlayStation 6 was indeed using a chiplet-based solution. Now, I don't know fully the design of the APU at this point. However, at the very least, I think that we're going to see a very large cache chiplet, potentially several of them, which basically is going to be having some maybe 2.5D or maybe 3D packaging, what have you. Again, the exact specifics I'm not too certain about at this stage, but I think it makes a lot of sense. And you can kind of infer this not just from, well, again, my sources that have spoken to me, but also just the direction that AMD are taking with its own APUs. And ultimately speaking, I think that this is going to be a very interesting direction for Sony. I think that given the fact that, you know, the PlayStation 5 Pro kind of gives us a hint of what Sony will be doing. Obviously, it is using PSSR, and they are certainly pushing AI and compute. And I think that we can get a really good understanding that Sony needs a crap ton of memory bandwidth. For example, when Mark Cerny was discussing the PS5 Pro, he mentioned that, well, what do we do? If we use the L2 caches of the GPU for, you know, PSSR, yeah, that's not enough bandwidth. So basically, they were using essentially the workgroup processors caches and then essentially repurposing them for this. And I could get into a whole spiel about how, you know, the direction of Sony is going to be changing for the PS6, but basically the PS5 Pro really gives us a hint that for Sony, memory bandwidth and caches are extremely important. I think that the PS6 is going to be a very powerful console. That's just the feeling that I've been getting. Now, obviously, at the end of the day, the console is going to be targeting a specific price point. So no one, for example, is going to want to spend like $1,500 on a games console. But one of the really strong points of Sony is that they typically make very good design decisions. And by which I mean, they create a console, and by console I don't just mean the APU, I mean the SSD, I mean the APU, yes, but also memory choices and so on, in a very harmonious way, so they can maximize and squeeze the most performance out of it. The PS5, for example, essentially the whole point of the PS5 was getting data from the SSD, or storage if you will, into the GPU and the rest of the SoC as fast as possible. So for them to continue this design philosophy with this PS6 makes a lot of sense to me. Having a large amount of cache on die means that you don't need to worry so much about GDDR7, I'm assuming, bandwidth. And it's not just about the actual bandwidth, it's also things like latency as well. While 5, 10, 15 nanoseconds doesn't sound like a big deal, it can actually mean that you're missing frame targets, or just one thing can't complete because you're waiting for data to come from another thing. It's going to be a very interesting generation. Again, graphics are certainly going to be evolving significantly by the time the PlayStation 6 comes to the market, and it's going to be very interesting to see what the main selling points of that console are. With that said, guys, hopefully you have enjoyed the video. If you have, well, it's YouTube, so leave a like and all that stuff. I'll see you soon. Take care of yourselves. Bye for now.